video, we have discussed MIS diodes, and in this video lecture, we see the frequency dependent CV characteristics of these MIS diodes. For here, I am taking an example of MOS structure. That is metal, oxide, and semiconductor. And I'm sure that all of you know about MOS transistor. So, same transistor, here we are going to discuss. Here we are going to discuss their CV characteristics. So, simply we can say that the MOS structure would be acting as a simple parallel plate capacitor. With oxide like SiO2 in case of silicon, as dielectric if the semiconductor below it a perfect conductor. Or the interconductivity of the conductor is high. Because in a parallel plate capacitor, we have two conducting plates. But here, we have one metal, then a semiconductor, and in between, we have this oxide layer or insulating layers. So, here a semiconductor as perfect conductor means the doping in the semiconductor must be very high. But however, there are many differences between a simple capacitor, parallel plate capacitor, and this MOS structures. Because here this oxide layer depends upon the gate voltage. So however, the MOS capacitor is more complicated because the surface charge layer in the semiconductor under the gate metal is modified by the gate voltage. So this is the major difference between a normal parallel plate capacitor and a MOS based capacitor, because in a normal parallel plate capacitors, the thickness of the insulating layer cannot be changed. But here, thickness of this insulating layer, that is the space charge layer or depletion layer, can be changed by the gate voltage. So this is very important point to note. So now let us analyze the effect of this layer on the capacitance of the MOS system. So here I am taking an example of a MOS structure with a p-type semiconductor. Now let me draw the energy band diagram for this MOS structure. So this is metal. Let me use some fancy colors this time. So this is metal. This is an oxide or insulating layer. And there is a downward bending in the semiconductor. Since I am taking a p-type, so let me draw it here. So this is, here is the Fermi level in the semiconductor side, and this is the vacuum level for metal. This is the Fermi level for metal, and this is the EC or semiconductor, and this is EV, and this is the Fermi level for the semiconductor. So here we have applied a gate voltage VG. So This is oxide layer. This is semiconductor layer or semiconductor. And this is metal. We can also draw, if you want, this is the Fermi level EI, that is for intrinsing. So now we can see here that we have this oxide layer is acting as an insulating layer with these two electrodes. So this whole component is acting as a parallel plate capacitor. So when we apply a gate voltage, so when a voltage VG is applied on the gate, and here I am not explaining the how we can use a gate source all these terminals, because I am considering that you know about these things. So when a voltage VG is applied on the gate, a part VOX of it will drop or appear across the oxide, so that we are applying a gate voltage VG to this structure. So some part of this VG as VOX will be dropped at this oxide layer and remaining in the semiconductor. So our total VG can be reflected as VOX, that is the voltage drop across this oxide layer, plus phi S, that is voltage drop across the semiconductor, we can simply say. If no charges are located at the oxide semiconductor interface, the electric flux or electric field density will be continuous at the interface, and from Gauss laws we can write epsilon S ES, which is equal to epsilon OX VOX by DOX, and we know that according to Gauss law this is equal to minus QS, where EOX is the permittivity of the oxide layer. Epsilon S is the permittivity of the semiconductor. DOX is the oxide thickness. And ES is the electric field. At the semiconductor surface, so this electric field ES is when there is no space charge accumulation at the interface of oxide and semiconductor. But let me write it as equation number 1, this is equation number 2. And from here we can put the value of this Vux to the equation 1. And after putting that value, equation 1 will become as Vz, which is equal to minus Qs by Cox plus Phi S. Here I am using a simple relation of capacitance where Cox is equal to epsilon Ox by DOX per unit area. Here A is 0, so A is unity. So by using this formula from equation second, we are putting this value in equation number third. So this is a relation between gate voltage and the charge and capacitor of the oxide. If we differentiate this equation 3 with respect to Vz, so on differentiating equation 3 with respect to Vz, we can get one which is equal to minus 1 by COX DQS by DVG plus d phi s by d q s into d q s by d v g. We are just multiplying numerator and denominator by d. This is q s. And this is phi s. And we know that the small signal capacitance of the MOS capacitor is defined by the relation that is C, which is equal to d q z by d v g. Or we can use d q s by d v g. Because QZ is the charge accumulated at the gate side and minus QS is the charge accumulated at the source side. So here QZ is equal to minus QS is the charge per unit area on the gate electrode. So this is our equation number, I think this is third, this is equation number fourth, and this is equation number fifth. So we can put this value from equation 5 to equation 4. So on substituting the value of d q s by d v z from equation number 5 to equation number 4, and after rearranging the terms, we get one by C which is equal to 1 by COx plus 1 by Cs. So this is our equation number 6, and this is the equation that we are needed for. And here Cs is nothing but minus dqs by d phi s. Which is the semiconductor space charge capacitance per unit area. So this is the, since this is a MOS structure, so if this is metal, then this is oxide layer, and then here this is semiconductor. So one capacitor is forming due to this oxide layer, and another capacitor is forming at the semiconductor side due to depletion region. And we know that what is the characteristic of that capacitor. So here we can find two capacitors in series. So in above equation C, we can use a term that is known as normalized capacitance, that is C or COx, which is equal to 1 plus COx by Cs. So this is our final equation, and using this equation we can draw a CV characteristics at various frequencies. So here C by COx is the normalized capacitance. And we can see here this normalized capacitance depends upon the COx, that is oxide capacitance and semiconductor capacitance. If this semiconductor capacitance is maximum, then this term will become zero and this normalized capacitance will become 1 or equal to unity. And for a given oxide thickness, that is DOX, COx is constant. That is, if the thickness of the oxide layer is not changing, then the capacitance of this oxide layer is also not going to change. So if DOH is constant, CH is constant, and it is independent of the gate voltage. Here we are using this wording because here we are going to fix the gate voltage, and at a particular voltage we will vary the frequency so that we can draw a curve between capacitance and VG at various frequency. Hence, if the voltage dependence of CS is known, the ratio of CO-CH, that is normalized capacitance, can be plotted as a function of VG. So if VS is known, we can plot a graph between VG and normalized capacitance. So here on this scale, we have gate voltage VG in volts, and on this side we are having normalized capacitance. Since this is normalized capacitance, so its maximum value can be 1. So we can write here 0.2, 0.4, 0.6, 0.8 and 1. And in this side, this is minus gate voltage. So here I am drawing a relation between capacitance versus gate voltage. So this curve A is for low frequency and this curve B for high frequency. So in simple wording, we can see that when we apply a low frequency, that is around 100 hertz, then we can get this type of graph between normalized capacitance and gate voltage. And for higher frequency, we will get this response, which is B, and C is depletion approximation. Normally, we can divide this graph between three regions, that is this region, where it will start to is known as accumulation region. And we can say from here to here, this is depletion region. And from here to here, or this is also inversion region. Sometime this region from here to here is known as moderate inversion, and from here to here, this is strong inversion region. But here I am using only one word, that is inversion. So let's first consider the MOS system is in thermal equilibrium here, this point is known as flat band condition. That is, there is no band bending in the energy bands. And this thermal equilibrium condition can be obtained only at zero gate voltage or zero bias condition. Under this condition, the bands are flat and there is no charge in the semiconductor. And we know that for measuring CV characteristic, we have to apply a AC signal with the DC signal. So now let a small AC signal let a small AC signal now be applied to measure the capacitance of the system. The perturbation of the semiconductor surface by the small test signal produces an effective dynamic depletion region in the semiconductor whose thickness equals the extrinsic debye length LD, which is given by LD. That is K T epsilon S divided by Q square P naught plus N naught and under the root. So this is the debye length LD. And we can assume that for a strongly p-type semiconductor, where p naught is equal to acceptor density. And we can assume that N naught as compared to P naught is equal to 0 and substituting CS, which is equal to epsilon S by LD. In equation number 7. Let me write this equation as equation number 8. In equation number 7, the flat band capacitance C, which is equal to CFB, can be written as C flat band by COX, which is equal to 1 by 1 plus COX LD by epsilon S. Let me write this as equation number 9. So in this equation, we have simply replaced the C by CF, that is flat band capacitance. So when the gate voltage